Okay. Good evening. Good evening, Europe, and good morning, USA, right?
It is 10 a.m. Eastern. 7 a.m. Pacific.
Welcome to today's lecture in the frame of the module Emerging Fields in Architecture. Today the theme is gravity, space, and architecture. What happens to architecture if gravity is increased, decreased, or removed altogether? This is an exciting question and a very necessary one for future extraterrestrial buildings. It is also a question that relates back to the one of the basic ones in architecture itself. As our today's guest, Ted Hall, states in the description of his lecture, the shape may or may not be intentional. An unintentional shape is often a symptom of structural failure. Today, I'm happy to welcome Ted Hall, a long-term colleague and also former chair of the Space Architecture Technical Committee. His day job occupation is extended reality software development and consulting. As he calls it, his weekend avocation is space architecture with a specialization in artificial gravity. He has a bachelor's and master and doctoral degrees from the University of Michigan. And Ted Hall emerged from the Master of Architecture program in 1981 as a software developer for CAD and BIM and has evolved over the decades into virtual reality, advanced reality, mixed reality, and extended reality. His 1994 doctoral dissertation was on the architecture of artificial gravity environments for long-duration space habitation. He is a founding member of the Space Architecture Technical Committee, SATC, in the American Institute of Aeronautics and Astronautics, and chaired the SATC during 2010 and 2014. Ted Hall also chaired the Space Architecture Sessions at the International Conference on Environmental Systems during 2007 and 2010, and then again 2013 and 2014. I'm very happy that Ted Hall is here today because he is still the leading expert on artificial gravity and gravity space relationship. Thank you, Ted, for coming. The floor is yours.
Okay, I'm going to share my screen now. Thank you for the introduction. So let's see, sharing my PowerPoint here, hopefully. Does everybody see that? Okay, thank you. Okay, welcome to my presentation and thank you for the invitation. If this opening picture looks ridiculous, I guess it should, but I'll explain why it's ridiculous if you don't already sort of intuit that. This title in the abstract actually came from a book chapter, a museum catalog article I was invited to write 21 years ago. And so there's the bibliography entry, Gravity, Space, and Architecture. It was for an exhibition on that title that was in the the Art Institute of Chicago and the Museum of Flight in Seattle. At the bottom of the slide there is a URL. You can get the original, you can download that article. I deviated from that article in putting this slideshow together. There's some pictures in the article that are not in this PowerPoint from movies and popular culture, frankly, sort of ridiculous concepts that I didn't even bother to put here, but it's an easy read. And if you're curious, you can go get that paper. Anyway, without further ado, the theme is the same. So some opening observations. Gravity is the most unifying experience of all known life for the whole history of this planet, going back, 3.7 billion years when the first bacteria sort of showed up in the fossil record. Everything from bacteria to humans, whether it's at sea level or up on a mountain or in a cave, we've all had the experience of one gravity, and this cuts across all cultures. It doesn't care about race or skin color or gender, or again, whether you're a coastal fisherman or somebody living up in the mountains far away from the ocean. It cuts across all cultures. It cuts across all human experience for the entire existence of this planet. One gravity. There's no escaping one gravity. It's one thing we all share. And the same forms keep showing up over and over around the world. So, you know, we've learned as a species that can build structures, that pitched roofs are good for shedding precipitation. And whether it's an alpine ski lodge that has to shed the snow, or a grass hut in a rainforest, we keep seeing these same forms. You know, and they show up around the world. I don't think these guys learned how to build domes from the Romans, right? They arrived at that solution themselves using the materials that they had. And the available materials, the available technology might affect the span that you can achieve, but the basic form is the same. And it occurs throughout history, around the world, all cultures. We all share these same basic architectural forms. There are other things that influence architecture, like precipitation, for example. In a dry climate, maybe I don't need that pitched roof. Maybe I can get away with a flatter roof. But post and beam architecture is still a pretty ubiquitous thing around the world. So gravity shapes architecture. And this theme has been built into architectural theory and philosophy. Authors have devoted books to this idea that gravity shapes architecture. Christian Norberg Schultz, Genius Loci Towards a Phenomenology of Architecture, Thomas Tice Evanson, Archetypes in Architecture. So Norberg Schultz says the boundaries of natural and man-made space are moreover to be defined in terms of floor, wall, and ceiling. He never uses the word gravity, but clearly that's what distinguishes those surfaces. And Tice Evanson, pretty much the same idea. He says floor, wall, and roof. But again, he builds a whole architectural grammar around those concepts. So gravity shapes architecture, whether intentionally or otherwise. This is a professional football stadium where the Detroit Lions used to play. It was called the Silver Dome. You don't see much of a dome in that roof. It's pretty flat, but they called it the Silver Dome. And this is what happened to it when it fell into disrepair and was hit with more snow load than it could handle. It's not a dome anymore. It's an inverted dome. Thank you, gravity, right? Here's a condition, an example where probably that pitched roof shed the snow nicely, but it fell on a flat section of the roof. Something like this probably was here, and people didn't clear that snow off, and so down it comes, right? Gravity shapes architecture on this planet, whether we like it or not. So gravity is the most unifying experience. Gravity shapes architecture. And yet, ironically, gravity is the one thing we cannot bring with us when we go away from Earth. We can bring food, we bring air and water, we bring clothing, we bring our language, we bring our culture, but we can't bring gravity, or parenthesized, or can we? I'll talk about that later. So 2000 years ago, Vitruvius, in his 10 books on architecture, he said, if our designs for private houses are to be correct, we must at the outset take note of the countries and climates in which they are built. And about 100 years ago, Hermann Oberth wrote, other laws prevail in space, and there is no reason why the old architectural rules should be followed. So what are our gravitational climates away from Earth? There's three here. I'm going to talk about one at a time here, starting with microgravity, which is better known as weightlessness. In 1969, there was a series of articles, or a long article with multiple parts, if you want to think of it that way. Alice D. Rung, Spaces in Space, Progressive Architecture. There's the reference there. And it documented a collaboration between an architectural firm, Warner Burns Tone and Lund, and Grumman Aerospace. And 1969 November, This was the month of the second moon landing, Apollo 12. So the first moon landing had just happened a few months earlier. People were very excited about the arrival of the space age, and lots of people were going to be living in space, and it was going to be this different environment, and there was going to be microgravity and lunar gravity, and what does it all mean, and how can we live there? This is clearly kind of a confused image. Nobody quite knows what it means. So we have this guy sitting at a table, the chairs and the table seem to be stuck to the floor. And yet over here on the right-hand side, we've got somebody floating in microgravity. So people are, you know, trying to figure out, what does it mean? What happens to architecture when we move into space? So these architects, give them credit. They put some thought into what it means to be in microgravity, weightlessness. What will that do to floor, wall, and ceiling? And so they imagined if we had a two-deck, a multi-deck station, how would people move from one deck to another? For some reason, they had it stuck in their mind that people would always go from one deck to the other head first. I don't know why they didn't perceive of going through foot first, but they imagined in this case, if they preserved a consistent up-down between those two decks, they imagined, well, this guy has to flip upside down to go through the, you know, the opening and then flip again to get on this floor. And apparently they didn't think that was efficient. Or this one, you know, he can, if we have head to head, he can go through head first, but he still has to flip. And they ended up with this one. I mean, the person still is flipping to go through for whatever reason, but they decided that this foot to foot arrangement would be ideal. And so they came up with models like this. And whether it makes sense gravitationally, it sort of makes sense geometrically, actually. It wasn't a bad guess because, you know, if you think about this cylindrical shape, which we have to hold the pressure, other speakers in this series have talked about, you know, why everything is a cylinder or a sphere because of the atmospheric pressure. And so if you're going to have a flat floor, there's some logic in having it in the middle and having, you know, a sort of a domed ceiling or a arched ceiling. It kind of makes sense geometrically, whether or not it makes sense gravitationally. If you have not seen the movie 2001, A Space Odyssey, I highly encourage you to see it. It is both imaginative and realistic. I mean, in many ways, it's the most realistic depiction of space travel outside of Apollo 13, which was really almost documentary. But in terms of like long distance interplanetary travel and routine travel, you know, to the moon, really commercialized, this is a great movie. So this is a scene that's on a cislunar transfer vehicle from the Earth to the moon, and it's in weightlessness, and the stewardess, it's Pan Am, by the way, an old extinct airline. She comes out of the galley and walks around this cylinder to get herself upside down so she's in the same orientation as the passengers. She sort of comes in like this and walks around here and walks out because, you know, what difference does gravity make? There was this idea that it doesn't matter, right? We can throw away all these old theories about roof and floor and wall. None of it matters anymore. Well, what we could actually build in the near term was somewhat humbler than what people visualized. So there were, for example, a series of seven Salyut space stations, Soviet Salyut 1 through 7 from 1971 to 1991. The United States launched Skylab in 1973. The Russian Soviet Mir was up there from 1986 to 2001. And now we have the International Space Station. And these are all a bit more humble than what those architects imagined we would have by now. This is what the wardroom looked like in Skylab. And I'm not sure if this is a ground simulator or the actual orbital artifact. But if you look at the ceiling, you see this grid, this sort of triangular hexagonal grid. The actual flight environment had that same system on the floor. And the idea was that the astronauts would have these sort of cleats on their shoes that could lock onto that. And so they could walk on the floor, they could walk on the ceiling, but that would be how they would restrain themselves. Now, it's not the environment is clearly not totally agnostic as to which way is up, because this table is really only going to work from one orientation, it looks like. But they're weightless and they can float around and be in any orientation they want. But astronaut Ed Gibson noted that being upside down in the wardroom made it look like a different room than what we were used to. The attitude which we normally call up, the attitude in which we had trained. He noticed that if he rotated more than 45 degrees off of the orientation that they trained, it was like a different room. He couldn't recognize it. He couldn't orient himself. But if he rotated back right about 45 degrees, as he described it, all of a sudden it became familiar again. And so this is the International Space Station. You know, it's not quite as cozy and lounge-like as the architects imagined. And it's not that big. We don't really have a lot of room in there to do somersaults. When you watch videos of astronauts on ISS, they always look like they're sort of swimming down this corridor. But when they stop to do work, there's a floor and there's a ceiling. And if you look closely at these corners, you'll notice up here on the top corners, that's where the lights are, right? So it's not just gravity. There's lots of other things that sort of affect our choice of floor, wall, and ceiling and how we orient things. And it's just more efficient, especially in a confined space like this, to have a consistent up-down orientation of things. So even if there's no gravity, we evolved in a gravitational environment. Humans have an up and a down, whether or not there's gravity. We evolved with gravity, and it turns out it makes sense to continue to design with some sort of a consistent up and down. And so that was carried over into this transhab concept, which is a concept for a large inflatable habitat. And what's depicted here is three levels, but you'll notice that they're now conceiving this as, you know, consistent up, down, consistent orientation of the floor and the ceiling. And, you know, she can go through this whole feet first or head first, what difference does it make? And this is sort of based on lessons learned from Skylab and all these other space stations. They've realized that, you know, it doesn't necessarily work to make people flip all the time. Skylab workshop is still the largest volume that has ever been put in orbit in terms of a human habitable space. And by that, I mean, what's the biggest sphere that you could put in the habitat? The International Space Station, I think, is more volume overall, but it's very long and skinny. And the Skylab workshop was a large sort of, you know, almost spherical volume. And there was a lot of room in there for the astronauts to play around. You know, it would be a little disorienting. It took them a while to sort of get used to how to orient themselves. But they were up there for 84 days, which at the time was just mind-blowing that people could be in orbit for that long. Of course, that's only less than half of what's typical now on the International Space Station. But Skylab broke a lot of ground in learning how to live in weightlessness. And we learned that this is not exactly very healthy. So the irony is that gravity causes structures to fail, but lack of gravity causes human bodies to fail. And it's sort of a cascade failure. You can think of it that way, beginning with fluid redistribution. So on Earth, with gravity, we have more fluid pressure in our feet than in our head if we're standing up, right? Like anything else, like any other column of fluid, gravity pulls everything toward our feet, and we've evolved for that. That's what we've evolved for. Without gravity, there's a fluid redistribution. There's less pressure in our feet and more fluid pressure in our chest and in our head. And that sort of causes all these other things. It's like a cascade failure. So from fluid redistribution, we get the fluid loss, electrolyte imbalances, cardiovascular changes. The heart actually grows significantly in the first 24 hours because of all this fluid moving up. And then you lose fluid and it shrinks again. It gets smaller than it was before. Red blood cell loss because the total blood volume is reduced. Eye damage, this intraocular hypertension. This is something that was only discovered in the past 10 years. We'd been flying humans in space for decades, and the eye damage thing is something that's only recently sort of something we've become aware of. Muscle damage, bone damage, hypercalcemia. It turns out that The theory with bone formation is that bone is formed where it's needed and resorbed where it's not needed. And the theory is that it's a piezoelectric effect of bone tissue under stress. There's something that happens when bone is under stress that it attracts these mineral ions and bone gets built up. When you take that stress away, the minerals kind of dissolve back into the blood. And so that's what hypercalcemia is. And so trying to fix bone damage by putting more calcium in their diet is not necessarily going to work because the bones aren't keeping the minerals they had. And what you're going to do instead is increase their chance of getting kidney stones. Immune suppression, cell membrane thickening, vertigo and disorientation, nausea, malaise, olfactory suppression. You can't smell because of all the fluid in your head. It's like you have a head cold. Weight loss, flatulence. So in microgravity, gases that might have come out as a burp on Earth are more likely to come out as a fart in space. And so maybe it's a good thing we can't smell as well. Facial distortion, postural changes, coordination changes, on and it goes. And so it's just not healthy. We did not evolve to live in microgravity. And some people will debate this. They'll say, well, it's not that it's not healthy. It's an adaptation to a different environment. And so, you know, maybe we could live a long time in microgravity, but we will not be able to come back to Earth. You know, we'll become like squids and all of our bones will revert, you know, the bones will become cartilage again or something. But if you're going to spend your whole existence in microgravity, you know, maybe that's okay. But spending a lot of time in microgravity makes you unfit to return to life with gravity. So partial gravity on other planetary surfaces, what do we mean by partial gravity? If we look at all of the planets in our local star system, the only one that has significantly more gravity than Earth is Jupiter. Of course, Jupiter is a gas giant. So what is this? What do we mean by the surface of Jupiter? It's defined as the radius at which the gas pressure equals sea level atmospheric pressure on Earth. That's what they define as the surface of Jupiter, where the gas pressure equals Earth's sea level pressure. So at that radius from Jupiter, it's 2.7 times Earth's gravity, which is a lot, but we're not going to Jupiter. Even if you could build some habitat that would somehow float in the clouds up there, there is not the resources that we need to live. I mean, there's nothing there, no reason to go there. And no way to live there. Saturn, even being another gas giant, is only 15% more gravity than Earth. Same with Neptune, ice giant, but it's only 15% more gravity than Earth. Among the rocky planets, Earth is king. Earth is the most massive rocky body in this star system. And everything else is less than Earth gravity. Uranus is only 92%, Venus 90%. And we can't go to Venus because it's a hellhole, right? It's a 80 atmospheres of pressure and hot enough to melt lead. And so we aren't going to be settling Venus anytime soon. We look at the surfaces we can go to. Mars and the moon are both significantly less gravity than Earth. And it's not clear that that's going to be enough to keep us healthy for coming back to Earth. Artists and, you know, science fiction types have liked to speculate on what architecture on the moon might look like. What is life on the moon going to be like? In 1958, there were these Topps chewing gum had these trading cards. I don't know if such a thing exists in Europe, but you'd buy bubble gum and it came with these cards, which you could collect and trade. And there was a whole series of these things devoted to living in space. So 1958, it's 1 year after Sputnik. It's still 3 years before Gagarin's flight. And they're trying to imagine, what is it going to be like? We're going to be on the moon soon. And what is it going to be like to be on the moon? So clearly there's less gravity. This guy can jump way up in the air. You see this weightlifter back here. He's got these huge barbells and he's lifting them with one hand. An interesting thing to consider is that 100 kilo mass on the moon, maybe in a sense, it only weighs what 17 kilos would weigh on Earth. But it still has the mass of 100 kilos. So you can get it off the floor and you can lift it, but it's still going to be a push to accelerate it. It's still not going to be just picking it up and throwing it in the air. It's still going to be slow going to accelerate this thing. And once he gets it up there, if it's a significant fraction of his own mass, and he gets that thing accelerating, if he keeps holding onto that barbell, it could potentially lift him off the floor. So a few years ago, I looked at, sort of inspired by that picture, I was thinking, well, what would happen with basketball? If we play basketball on the moon, how is that going to look? So here's a picture of a typical NBA game. In the US, the rim height is set at 10 feet. I don't know if they round that off to 3 meters in Europe or in the Olympics, but close enough to 3 meters. And if we do an analysis of the energy of a jump, and if you think about how a jump works, it starts by bending your legs, right? You're not just sort of standing on the floor and suddenly leap up. It starts with you bend your knees and you stoop down and then you spring up, right? That's how you jump. So the jump starts in this posture with your knees bent. And then you straighten your legs. And while you're doing that, you're adding energy to yourself, right? From there to there, your muscles are putting energy into that jump. But once your feet leave the floor, energy is constant. And you've given yourself a little bit of potential energy by raising your center of gravity, your center of mass off the floor. And you've given yourself some kinetic energy that continues to carry you up. And from the point your feet leave the floor, kinetic energy is being converted to potential energy, but the energy is constant. So my analysis was, how much energy does it take for him to touch the rim? And if we put that same energy into a jump on the moon, how high does the rim have to be? And I came up with 25 feet is what that would be. Now, there's a lot of wiggle room in that analysis. Other people might come up with very different numbers, but I think this is sort of a reasonable first guess. So basketball on the moon is going to be a sort of a strange experience because he can jump up there, but he's not going that much faster. It's just, he's going a longer distance. So it's going to be sort of a slow motion game, you know, still going to take him a bit of time to get up to 25 feet and come back down again. So gravity shapes architecture. When there is no gravity, there's no atmospheric pressure. And so therefore the internal pressure of the habitat becomes one of the major shapers of architecture. That's why, again, and other speakers have mentioned this, I know, that's why space habitats tend to be cylinders and spheres because they're good tensile structures and they can contain an atmosphere. But without an atmosphere, there's also no radiation protection as we have on Earth. And so we have to bury these habitats with regolith or something to get radiation protection, in which case gravity comes into it again. And so gravity is still shaping it. And so this is more, you know, realistic. What's actually being looked at for near-term lunar habitats is something like this. And it ends up being a dome again. We're limited in scale by what we can actually launch on rockets and get to the moon, either in terms of actual habitats or in terms of construction equipment to build habitats. But it's going to be a while before we can build these, you know, massive, very large volume structures. And so, you know, if even though it's 1/6 gravity, you look at the design and it looks like they've designed it like Earth, which is, you know, it's going to be very difficult to walk on that surface. And this is something that never really seems to come across in any of these concepts. They always show people just standing upright as they would on Earth. But if he tries to walk like that, he's not going to have enough traction on the floor. His feet are just going to skid because there's not enough gravity. If you look at how the Apollo astronauts moved on the moon, they had this very sort of loping, hopping stride because it was the only way. In order to push on the ground hard enough to get any traction, you're lofting yourself into the air. And so, you know, they're going to need like a Velcro carpet or something and Velcro shoes to be able to walk on that floor and not bang their head on the ceiling. And even large, you know, big, large inflatable, in this case, concepts, pretty large volume, they've still sort of divided it into these kind of, you know, 3 meter slices for floors. And it's like, where can I play basketball? I noticed something. I wish I could zoom on this picture easier, but this top level, I don't know if you can see my cursor. The top level here appears to be an exercise area. And something I noticed just last night when I was putting these slides together still, I don't know if you can see my cursor right there, that little feature there, that's a guy and he's running around a track and he's almost horizontal. And I never noticed that before. And I thought, well, that's pretty clever. That should be highlighted somehow. But it was an interesting discovery on my part to see that the artist or the engineer, the designer, whatever, had considered that. If you think about Olympic cycling tracks and how much they're banked, right? Because the cyclists are going around and they've got this supposedly a centrifugal force. I'll talk about that later, but for now we'll use that term. And so they're riding on this very banked track. Well, lunar gravity is very low. And if he runs with much speed at all, he may generate most of the gravity that he feels by running around there. So this is not unreasonable, I think. He's almost horizontal running on that track because lunar gravity is so low. And his own acceleration running around that track is going to be possibly larger than what the gravity is. Anyway, that was a surprising discovery for me when I was looking at this picture last night. So that's a nice segue into artificial gravity. What is artificial gravity? If we're going to design gravity, we need to know something about the theory of gravity and how gravity works. So if we look at contemporary physical theory, and I'm not a physicist, but I read some, okay, you all read some. There are considered to be four fundamental forces or four fundamental interactions in the universe, and everything that happens in the universe can be attributed to one of these four things. Three of them conform to the standard model of particle physics, and this is all the quantum physics that you hear about all the time, the quantum weirdness. So we have the strong nuclear force, the weak nuclear force, and the electromagnetic force. Supposedly, they have theoretically unified the weak and the electromagnetic forces. Like right after the Big Bang, those were the same force. And for whatever reason, when the universe cooled, they bifurcated into two different forces. I'm not an expert in this stuff. I only know what I read, and this is what I've read. But Wikipedia has, you know, articles on all this stuff. The strong force has not been unified with those yet. And if they could, that would be what they call a grand unified theory. The so-called GUT theory, gut theory, grand unified theory, still does not include gravitation. It would include all of these quantum forces, but still would not include gravitation. And it has been a pursuit of the greatest minds in physics for the past century to try to come up with a quantum theory of gravity. And they have not arrived at it yet. This is the sort of thing that Stephen Hawking used to, you know, spend his time thinking about, and lots of other people. But it turns out it doesn't matter because we actually have no sensitivity to gravity. There's nothing in our body that's sensitive to gravity. What we're sensitive to are mechanical and chemical interactions, and those are both ultimately due to the electromagnetic interaction. All mechanical and chemical interactions, including biomechanical and biochemical, are ultimately due to the electromagnetic interaction, not gravity. And there's proof of this all around us. We just have to open our eyes and see it. Here's an astronaut in space. He's weightless. It's not because there's no gravity. It's not microgravity. If you do the math, if he's at the altitude of the International Space Station, the gravitational field is still 89% of Earth's surface value, and yet he's weightless. And so some people will say, well, it's because he's in orbit and he's in some circular path and there's a centrifugal force that counteracts gravity. No, that's not true. He's not necessarily in orbit. Jeff Bezos on his Blue Origin rockets, he launches people up, they go up, they go down, and they're pretty much straight up and down. There is no circular path. And yet they're weightless. As soon as the rocket cuts off, they're weightless. It's got nothing to do with a circular path or centrifugal force. Also, if there was a centrifugal force that canceled gravity, that begs the question of why is the orbit circular to begin with? What's making it circular? The only reason the orbit is circular is because gravity is unopposed. Gravity is an unopposed centripetal force pulling things in. and nothing opposes it. There is no room in the mathematical analysis for a non-zero centrifugal force. It simply does not exist. If you think about the ISS or anything in low Earth orbit, it's moving at something like 27,000 kilometers per hour. If anything counteracted gravity, that thing would be gone. It would be nowhere near Earth. So nothing is bound, nothing is canceling gravity. And yet he's weightless. So Einstein had this fairly famous thought experiment. On the left there, we have a man in his laboratory, and he can perform different experiments about dropping a ball and watching it accelerate, or looking at the pressure differential in a column of fluid, or how structures bend, whatever. Einstein said, put a man in a chest way out in space, out in intergalactic space, far away from any kind of Newtonian gravity, and accelerate him. And every experiment that the man in the chest does runs exactly as if he were suspended motionless in a gravitational field. If he drops a ball, the ball stops accelerating, but the floor accelerates up to the ball. So what he sees is the ball accelerating toward the floor. Pressure in fluid columns behaved exactly the same. Deflections in structures, all the stresses, everything you could measure that had anything to do with gravity. This guy would observe them the same as this guy. And so Einstein concluded that a gravitational field exists for the man in the chest, despite the fact that there was no such field for the coordinate system first chosen. And he doesn't say artificial gravity field. He doesn't say something like a gravitational field. He doesn't mince words. He says a gravitational field exists. But if A is equivalent to B, then B is also equivalent to A, right? If acceleration is equivalent to gravity, then gravity is equivalent to acceleration. So if we can say that, we can also say this. An acceleration exists for the man on the planet, despite the fact that there was no such acceleration for the coordinate system first chosen. And so the only force, the only acceleration that matters is the upward push of the floor. It's the upward push of the floor that gives us weight, not the downward pull of gravity. And so therefore, we don't need a centrifugal force to replace gravity because we don't need gravity. What we need is the upward force, which is the centripetal force, the inward force of a rotating structure. That's what creates artificial gravity. So if weightlessness is the problem, then maybe mechanical acceleration is the solution. And there are different kinds of basically two sort of perpendicular aspects to acceleration. If the acceleration is aligned with the velocity, that's linear acceleration. And the result of that is that the velocity is constantly increasing. That's pretty much the definition of acceleration. Strictly speaking, acceleration is any change in velocity, either in the magnitude or in the direction. But this is what we typically think of as acceleration. Acceleration doesn't just mean fast. So going 120 kilometers an hour down the highway, that's not acceleration. Going from zero to 120 in 4 seconds, that's acceleration. So when you're getting on the highway and you put your foot on the gas and the car is speeding up and feel yourself pinned back in the seat, that's acceleration. Once you're on the street, on the road, going at constant velocity, you're not pinned in your seat anymore. And if it's a very smooth road and a very smooth ride, you might almost forget that you're moving at all. So when we're talking about acceleration, we're not just talking about going fast. We're talking about going faster and faster and faster and faster. And it's not sustainable because not only the energy, but the power approaches infinity. It's simply not sustainable. Energy equals work equals force times distance, and force is mass times acceleration, right? A little bit of math here. So force times distance would be energy. And so force times distance per unit time, which is velocity, is the rate of energy, which is power, right? So power is mass times acceleration times velocity. These are vectors. Again, they have both a magnitude and a direction. So this gets into vector math a little bit. We're talking about the dot product of two vectors, but when they're aligned, when those two vectors are aligned, it's just the algebraic product. It's just A times V, just like you learned in, you know, grade school mathematics. But there's also centripetal acceleration, in which the acceleration is always perpendicular to the velocity. So the velocity is here, but the acceleration is there. And so this doesn't do any work, actually. It doesn't consume any energy because in vector math, the dot product of perpendicular vectors is zero. The distance from that center point never changes. So that force never does any work. It takes work to get it spinning. It takes a little bit of energy to get that rotation started. But once it's going, it just, you know, you spin a top and it keeps spinning. It doesn't consume energy. If there's no friction, conservation of momentum keeps it spinning. And so this is sustainable. This is something we can do. We can create this acceleration and sustain it for indefinite period of time and finite energy. And so this is what so-called artificial gravity is based on. The equations are pretty simple. They look intimidating. There's not going to be a quiz at the end of this. Don't worry. Omega here represents the spin rate, and R is the radius of rotation. So the centripetal acceleration, it turns out it is the spin rate squared times the radius, to put it simply. Omega squared times R. I was going to say something about that, but anyway, lost my train of thought. There's also something, this is not a physical theory in the sense of Newton's theory of gravity. So Newton's theory of gravity, that the force is the product of the masses divided by the distance squared, that was based on millennia of observation of celestial objects, seeing how the stars seem to move and the planets seem to move, and figuring out, well, the math is easier if we let Earth move. And then Kepler noticed that the orbits were more like ellipses than circles, and the rate changes. And then Newton sort of pulled this all together, and he came up with this beautifully simple formula for his law of gravitation. These are not like that. These are not physical laws. These are strictly mathematical results. If you write the equation of motion for a particle moving in circular motion, and just using the definition of circular motion and acceleration, and doing the derivatives, doing trigonometry and calculus, these are the equations that come out. So these are not physical laws where, you know, we observe something rotating and derive these formulas to describe what we saw. It's actually just the opposite. These are purely mathematical derivations, and it turns out our observation matches what we computed, which sort of supports Newton's theory in terms of force equals mass times acceleration. Anyway, so we have centripetal acceleration, which is spin rate squared times the radius. There's something else called Coriolis acceleration, which I'll talk more about later. It turns out also to be proportional to the spin rate and proportional to somebody's relative motion within that rotating thing. So besides our so-called design gravity, which is the centripetal acceleration, if I move within that rotating environment, if I'm climbing a ladder, for example, other accelerations, other forces will start to impinge on me. And those are distortions of the gravity that I intended. And so another interesting thing to look at is the ratio of these things. What is the ratio of the Coriolis to the centripetal? And if you divide out the omegas, we end up with this. It turns out to be twice the ratio of the relative velocity to the tangential velocity of that rotating environment. Don't worry about it. If you get it, fine. If you don't, fine. I'll talk more about this later. But those are the sort of governing equations for designing artificial gravity environments. So gravity shapes architecture, but it shapes it differently for artificial gravity. So now all of a sudden our dominant form is going to be some kind of rotating thing, right, to get those centripetal accelerations. And this is not a new concept. Konstantin Tsiolkovsky, way back in 1903, was already thinking about weightlessness and the fact that humans need gravity, even before we had any evidence of that. I mean, this was still, you know, 60 years almost before anybody actually flew in space. But he already, just based on theory and math, sort of reasoned out that, yeah, you know, we might need some kind of acceleration to stay healthy in space. And so he was already thinking about big structures that would rotate on an axis. And then you can see, you know, here's the foot for this guy, and on the other side, the feet are here, the feet are sort of on the outside of the structure. And a lot of people in the early 20th century were thinking along these lines. The people were, even before Sputnik, people were in the 20th century were very excited about space. Rockets were being developed, and Isaac Newton had sort of opened the universe to us in terms of figuring out forces and motion, and people were thinking, yeah, we can go there, we can do these things. And you know, so there's these big sort of wheel-shaped things that becomes the dominant sort of form for artificial gravity. Von Braun's concept of a space station was very influential. This was published in a popular magazine called Collier's, which was seen by many people. Walt Disney did a series on this. So a lot of people were aware of this torus as a form for space stations. And so popular culture picked it up. Here's another one of these Topps chewing gum trading cards, space supply depot. People just knew somehow that space stations would be shaped like this. And if you look closely at this picture, it really doesn't make sense. If you look here, see if my cursor moving there toward the top left corner, it looks like there's a guy standing there waving. Well, if this thing was spinning, of course, he'd be, you know, thrown off on a tangent to infinity someplace. And all of these windows would be in the floor. But it's people just knew that that's what a space station looked like. That was the picture they had in their mind based on everything they'd seen up to that point. Even if they didn't understand why, they just somehow they knew that was the form. When they started to get more serious, when engineers started to get more serious about, well, how are we going to get this thing up there? How are we going to build it? It needs to be something that we can pack onto rockets, and it has to look something like a rocket. So here's a Lockheed Corporation concept. Again, this is now 3 years after Sputnik, but still a year before Gagarin. But serious engineering, you know, aerospace engineering companies are already starting to think about, we're going to build space stations. How are we going to build them? How are we going to launch them? And so again, this is something that is rotating like this, the idea is. So you've got one axis there that's like, you know, the neutral rotation axis, and then the habitat areas, the laboratory areas are on these other cylinders. But this looks like something that can be put on a rocket and launched into space. We kind of know how to build this. We can imagine how we can build this with our current technology. Here was another interesting concept of six-sided torus. From NASA Langley Research Center in North American Aviation, 1962. We're now a year past Gagarin, the space race is on. They're gonna build a space station, so we better build a space station. We don't know why yet, but we know we gotta build one. But six-sided, this is pretty unique being six-sided like this. But this was their logic. They were conceiving of, again, how can we pack this thing into a rocket and get it up in space and deploy it? And so this thing was called an automatically erectable modular torus. And the idea was they would launch it, fold it up like this, and all these connections were hinged. And once it got into space, it would sort of unfold and end up with this six-sided shape. But they knew that that wasn't necessarily going to work for gravity, because the acceleration vector, the centripetal acceleration vector, is always pointed at the center of rotation. And so they knew, even though these segments are straight, they knew they were going to have to build some sort of an arched floor within that to keep the person's feet, to keep that floor perpendicular to what the apparent gravity was going to be. And so it gets tricky toward the end here. He's not going to have a lot of headroom if the aspect ratio of that cylinder is too narrow compared to its length. It's going to get tricky at the end. And they built some rotating space station simulators to figure out, well, we know people aren't necessarily comfortable rotating, right? People get dizzy. And so what are the comfort conditions? How much gravity do we need to walk, and how much gravity or how much rotation can people tolerate before they're sort of puking all the time? And so this was a rotating space station simulator that was, this was built at Langley Research Center, if I remember correctly. And there's a nice video of this online, and I'm going to try to play it now, hopefully. I'm going to escape out of my PowerPoint here for a second, and I'm going to stop sharing for a moment here. And I'm going to switch to, hopefully, this guy. And see if I can play this. All right, sorry. Oops. Sorry about this. I gotta get back to Zoom. Sharing the wrong, I just shared my PowerPoint again, sorry. I wanna share this one, sorry, that's what I want. Okay, this is what I'm looking for. Yep. Maybe I can make this big. So this is on YouTube. And you can see this guy in the orange suit walking around while that thing rotates. Close-up view, walking in the direction of rotation, 0.01 gravity. So the camera is rotating with the structure. You can see the shadows that seem to be rotating. So, you know, it's kind of like walking on the moon, as I was saying. It's very difficult to walk in such low gravity. You saw how much he had to bend over at the beginning just to get enough traction to get himself started. He's hanging horizontally. It's a very elaborate structure they've got him on. Remember that thing is rotating like this, and he's got all these cables that are supporting him. So he still has this earth gravity kind of pulling him down toward the ground. I can't imagine that was very comfortable. It's sort of ironic that they were doing comfort studies and anything like that. So half of gravity now, half of earth gravity, spinning faster. It's a little bit easier for him to get started walking. Now zero gravity. So he's going to basically be creating his own gravity. But somebody, he has no traction until he's moving. So here's a worker just giving him a push to get him started. But once he gets moving, his own rotation is sort of creating gravity for himself. And now here he is stopping. See how he's got no traction? And the slower he goes, you know, now he's weightless again. And this is walking against the rotation. And you see how hard it is for him to get started. It's not because he's heavier or putting a lot of effort into it. He has no traction until he gets started. Once he gets started, then he can sort of walk, but you know, he's so or actually what just happened is he canceled the rotation of, you know, the thing was rotating and he was standing still, so he had a little bit of gravity when he started. But anyway, let me get back to, I have to stop this thing. Let me get back to. You come back in pretty good shape. Plus, I did space fast myself. Close that. Get back to my Zoom and back to sharing my PowerPoint, which is this one. Right. Okay. I'm on a little tiny Mac screen, so forgive me while I click around here. Okay, so moving on. And there's a close-up view of him, you know, with these this elaborate cable system supporting him. So based on studies like that, they tried to come up with comfort charts for artificial gravity. What can people be comfortable in? And so it's got typically the boundaries on this one, at least on the vertical axis, we've got the rotation speed. How fast is it spinning? That's on the horizontal axis, the RPM. And the vertical axis is the radius. What's the radius of rotation? And this is a logarithmic chart. So what would be parabolas come out as straight lines if you do the math. This line here represents one gravity. There's no reason to go above one gravity. We need some minimum. This one set the minimum at some ridiculously low value, 0.35 g, which is useless. I don't know why they put it there. These lines represent the tangential velocity, the rim speed of that. And it's more comfortable if we have a higher rim speed, because the faster this thing is moving, the less difference it makes his walking speed. You know, if this is moving very fast, it doesn't matter too much whether he's walking forward or backward. It's just not going to make much difference. Versus if this is running, if this is very slow and he walks, it makes a big difference. So we want a high tangential velocity. This is saying that the rotation rate should not exceed 4 RPM. That's what this line is. We should be below 4 RPM, close to one gravity, but not more. Some above some minimum and above some minimum tangential velocity. When you look at this graph and everything is very hard edged, it looks so definite, like these are hard boundaries. And you know, if I'm here at 3.9 RPM, everything is fine. But if I go up to 4.1, everything falls apart. Well, different people looked at that same data and came up with different limits. And I won't belabor all of these things. They're hard to compare because they choose different variables for the axes. Some are logarithmic, some are linear. Some put rotation rate on the vertical, some put it on the horizontal. This one says 6 RPM is okay, but 2 RPM is optimal. This one also says 6 RPM, but the axes are different. It's actually basically the same as the first graph, but it has flipped the X and Y axes. And this one has all kinds of different limits for different sorts of activities. And this one has got limits, actually structural limits for what a tether can carry, a structural tether, how much load can it carry. But it's very difficult to understand. They're all different, and they're hard even to compare because they're all in different formats. This is what you get if you sort of take all of those things and beat them into the same format. And so I did this, and I sort of color-coded each of these zones according to how many votes it got, you could say. Of all those five different comfort charts, where was the agreement? And so the green is the area that everybody agreed on. 1G, maybe, you know, but probably at least 0.3G to have enough traction for walking. We really don't know what the lower level is for maintaining health yet. That's still a big unknown. Lunar gravity would be around here someplace, but we don't know if that's enough to stay healthy in terms of returning to Earth. Some set the upper limit for rotation to 2 RPM. Some set it as high as 6. Some say 4, some say 3. So it gets very kind of, you know, ambiguous here, which is how comfort works, right? Comfort is not a hard-edged thing. It's that different people are comfortable and different people are uncomfortable in the same situation. And it has to do also with adaptation and incentive and just your whole sort of psychological makeup, whether you can adapt to this environment or not. These are the rim speed, 6 meters per second, 10 meters per second. So anyway, that's what you get if you sort of combine all those things. That's sort of what the comfort bounds look like. So based on that sort of study, we know we need a big radius. And so they started thinking, well, how do we make a really big radius? And so they started looking at binodal things like this. So we've got two modules here that are connected by a very long wire tether, like a suspension bridge in a sense, right? It's just structural cable connecting these things, and it's rotating around like that. That's one way to get a long radius without a huge mass for a small crew. This was a concept for a 50-man station based on a long truss, but the same idea. And those early pictures I showed from the architectural firm Warner Burns Tone and Lund, notice this is the same year, 1969. This is the sort of space station they thought they were designing for, something that could have gravity on the lower decks and maybe microgravity toward the center, you know, in a cylindrical sort of plan. Again, the movie 2001 Space Odyssey, I highly recommend this movie. But a big wheel, right? It has to be a big wheel to keep people comfortable. Big radius and not spinning too fast. It's interesting that Paolo Soleri in 1969 was already thinking about this Asteromo space colony. And I'm going to have to go back and look at this and find out what his inspiration was, because it's sort of intriguing to me that he picked up on this. At first, I thought that he was copying the Stanford Taurus, but this didn't come for another 6 years later. These were NASA-sponsored studies, the Stanford Taurus and the Bernal Sphere. And the question arose, well, how big can we make these? How big could we possibly make a rotating space station? And they realized, well, we can build colonies using 1970s structural materials, known alloys of aluminum and steel. We can make things a kilometer in radius, and it can, we can build enough, and theoretically we can build enough land area to house 10,000 people. Both of these are concepts for colonies for 10,000 people living in orbit, just living at the distance of the moon from the Earth, you know, quarter of a million miles away in something that rotates at one RPM. And there's a whole society sort of based on this concept now. The National Space Society is very sort of, you know, gung-ho for promoting space colonies. It has been estimated that there are enough asteroidal materials to build the equivalent land area of 100 Earths. We could supposedly support a population of a trillion humans in the solar system by building space habitats like this. Whereas going to Mars, the land area of Mars is about equal to the dry land area of Earth. You colonize Mars, you've doubled maybe, you know, the available land area, but with exponential growth, where does that get us? But building space colonies like this, so the argument goes, we have huge, huge potential for growth throughout the solar system. The interesting thing is you zoom in on this Bernal sphere concept, and what do we see for the houses? We're still seeing these sort of gingerbread houses with the pitched roofs. Why is that? It's because this is a metaphor, right? This is trying to tell a story. This is not a construction document. It's not necessarily theoretically based. But if they drew some bizarre thing in there, some unrecognizable shape, it wouldn't tell the story they're trying to tell. But, you know, so they put houses that people recognize, take a house from Earth, and what would it look like if we were to do that? What would it look like if we put it in the sphere? So it manages to give us a sense of scale for how big the sphere is. But nobody should take this as a construction document and build this, because all of this stuff needs to be reevaluated in artificial gravity. There's just no reason to build it like that, probably. So this is the last part of the presentation, some practical principles on artificial gravity. And I just sort of took this verbatim from another presentation. First of all, the cardinal directions are inside out, the north, south, east, west. On the left side of this figure is a diagram of what we typically think of as these directions. If you think of holding a globe in your hand, and you point your thumb toward the North Pole, your fingers point east with your right hand, right? Your fingers point east, your thumb points north, and that's how we define those directions. Well, in artificial gravity, we're not looking at the palm of our hand, we're not looking at the knuckles of our hand, we're looking at the palm. And so those directions get reversed, right? We're not looking at this side of our hand anymore, we're looking at the concave side. And so the orientation of east relative to north is backward from what we're used to. And so we're not in Kansas anymore. We can't design as if we were in Kansas. Comfort limits are fuzzy, I just mentioned that. And they're especially fuzzy down here in this corner. And this is where all the pressure is for engineers. This is where they want to design, because the minimum radius and rotation also represents the minimum mass and energy. It's going to be the cheapest thing to build. It's the most affordable artificial gravity, but it's in this very fuzzy area where a lot of people are not going to be comfortable, or they're going to need some time to get comfortable in that environment. But weightlessness is like that also. People are not immediately comfortable when they go to weightlessness. Am I muted? I don't know how I got muted. Can you hear me, anybody?
Yes, we can hear you.
Was I muted? I just got a thing on my screen that I was muted.
For 2 seconds, you were muted.
Oh, I don't know how that happened. Thanks for the warning. Microgravity is not immediately comfortable. Astronauts spend 1 to 3 days getting over their nausea in microgravity. So artificial gravity does not necessarily have to be immediately comfortable. If it takes them 1 to 3 days to adapt to artificial gravity, it's no worse than microgravity, and it's better because of the health benefits, probably, we think. Oops. And so I have a calculator online. You can just Google for spin calc, and it'll bring you to this calculator, and you can play with these values, these parameters. You can put in any two, and the calculator will compute the other two, and it'll give you a little indication of how it computed it. These are just all the initial values, but you can come in here, type a number, pick your preferred measurement unit, and it'll recalculate things. And these colored icons sort of represent where that value sits on that comfort chart? Are you in the green zone? Are you in the yellow zone? Should it be higher? Should it be lower? And again, these bounds are very fuzzy. I'm not 100% sure I should be doing something as discrete as this. I should probably fuzz it up more. But centrifugal force is a bad idea, as I already talked about in terms of orbit. It does not help you solve anything. And so actually I presented a whole conference paper based on this, why centrifugal force is a bad idea. And there's a publication you can download and read. But it's not useful for solving problems. If I'm in a rotating environment and I hold a particle up 2 meters up and I drop this particle and I want to compute where is that going to hit the floor? If I take the approach of, well, there's a centrifugal force that's pushing the particle to the floor, but as it accelerates, it has velocity, and then there's a Coriolis acceleration that's perpendicular to the velocity, but that velocity changes the acceleration. And so acceleration depends on itself. And so I'm looking at, you know, is this getting into upper calculus differential equations, or do I have to do some kind of piecewise integration? How am I going to solve this? Does it depend on how fast it's spinning, the amount that ball deflects? Is it related to the gravity level? Is it related to how fast it's spinning? If you look at it from an inertial perspective, it becomes dead simple. It doesn't look dead simple, but it is dead simple. Once he lets go of that particle, there's no force acting on it. You know, there's a little bit of spinning air is pushing on it, but if we ignore atmospheric effects over here on the left or on the right, once he lets go of the particle, it's just momentum is carrying it on a straight line until it hits the rim. There is no centrifugal force. There's no force. It's just momentum carries it until it hits the rim. But he's rotating. And in the time it takes the particle to get from here to here, the observer has rotated from here to here. And so it seems like the particle is lagging behind him. That's why he sees that deflection. He's the one deflecting, not the particle. And so the math, I mean, it's a little bit of trig, but it's not calculus, it's not differential equations, it's not piecewise integration. It's basically high school algebra to solve that. And you can tell from the diagram, it doesn't matter how fast this thing is spinning. It can be spinning faster, it can be spinning slower, but the curvature of that path, the apparent curvature, it's a static solution, right? The geometry doesn't change. The geometry is independent of how fast it's spinning. It is sensitive, however, to this ratio. What is the ratio of the height to the rotational radius? And the smaller that is, the straighter the path. So this big path here is if it's only a 10 meter radius, but if it's 100 meters, it falls straighter. If it's 1,000, it's straighter. If it's 10,000, 10 kilometer radius, it's pretty straight. It's almost Earth normal. And so I use this as a sort of a measurement for how normal the gravity is going to feel. How do particles behave? Because that sort of paints a picture of artificial gravity. If we throw a particle, it's a similar situation. We're adding the tangential velocity of the station to whatever relative velocity. So this is a particle. It's like hopping off the floor, somehow, you know, straight off the floor. But it's got a velocity from the tangential speed of the station and plus whatever he added. So now it's cutting a chord across, but it's still just following a straight line. And the observer is still rotating, but now the particle's gotten ahead of him. So instead of deflecting to the west, it deflects to the east. And again, this is relative to this velocity ratio. The smaller v, the smaller the relative velocity compared to the tangential velocity, the straighter that path is. That's why we want that rim speed to be big. If this rim speed, capital V, if that's very fast, relative to the relative speed. So this ratio is small, things are normal. If that ratio is big, things become very abnormal. Centripetal acceleration is always centripetal. It's always pointed toward the center of rotation. So it doesn't matter how you've built your floors. I've seen concepts like this. This is another one of these binodal things. It's supposed to be spinning around this point. And quite often when they do interior drawings of these modules, they just have flat floors, but flat floors don't work because if the diameter of that module is large relative to the radius of rotation, there's going to be a significant slope that gravity vector is going to slope significantly compared to that floor if that ratio is big, and that has to be designed for. We see concepts like this is the Pioneer Station concept from a company called Orbital Assembly. They're marketing this. They claim they're going to build this and put it in orbit in a few years. And they've got these, you know, sort of straight modules. It looks like all the bend is in these little elbows. And so you wonder, well, what's going on in here? I don't know what the right proportions are for that. I tried to estimate. If they're building it like this, they're building it wrong. It's because of that, right? It's really a significant deviation from the centripetal vector to the gravity doesn't care. Centripetal acceleration doesn't care if you've got a flat floor. It cares about where that center of rotation is. And so they need to build it like that. If we look very closely at this section, it looks like it's kind of subtle, but it looks like they do have a little bit of curvature in this floor. So I think they're doing it right. Coriolis acceleration differentiates east and west. If we look at what happens when somebody's walking on that flat floor, so walking east to west on a flat floor, his centripetal acceleration is toward the center of rotation, but there's a Coriolis acceleration that's always perpendicular to his velocity. So if he's walking like that, the Coriolis is always pointed up. And if we add those two accelerations, the effect is that all of the acceleration vectors, the sum of those accelerations, converge on a point above the center of rotation. So here's the center of rotation, and here's where those vectors are converging. If he switches direction and walks the other way, the Coriolis acceleration also reverses, and now that convergence point is moved down. And so what he feels, his up vector is determined by that acceleration. The total acceleration vector is what's determining his up. And so in his body frame of reference, this is what he experiences. When he's trying to walk on that straight floor, even though it looks straight, it feels like it's teetering over this hill. And the interesting thing is if he walks east to west, the gravity is less, but the hill is steeper. Climbing a ladder is a special case of that, but a very important special case. The tan arrows here represent the tangential velocity of the rotating station, right? So at the rim, it's spinning very fast, and at the center, you know, it's not so fast. And it's a little easier to see here what the Coriolis acceleration is all about. As he climbs this ladder, down here, he's got a lot of tangential velocity, but he has to lose that velocity. He has to accelerate. He has to lose velocity as he goes toward the center. And if he goes all the way across, he has to pick it up again. So the Coriolis force is the force of that ladder pushing against him. As he climbs the ladder is slowing him down as he gets toward the center, and then it's speeding him up again as he goes toward the other side. And you'll notice west and east are, you know, everything's upside down and reversed as we rotate that around. So that's what the Coriolis force is about. As he's going up the ladder is pushing against him. You know, it's like an ice skater spinning, and she pulls her arms in and she spins faster from conservation of momentum. That space station, if he had enough mass, the whole space station would spin faster, but that's much more massive than he is. So the rotation of that thing is not going to increase. What it's going to do is push back on him or push forward on him as he's climbing that ladder. And so this is a mistake that shows up in a lot of designs. Here's this movie again, 2001 Space Odyssey. Great movie, but not perfect. They made mistakes. This guy climbing up and down the ladder, the Coriolis acceleration is in the plane of the ladder. And so this is what he's going to feel as he's trying to go down that ladder, up that ladder. It's going to feel like it's tilting like this. And the very easy solution is to turn that ladder 90 degrees. And so the Coriolis acceleration is always pushing him into the ladder, not pulling him off sideways. And one ladder does not work for going both up and down because the Coriolis acceleration changes. So again, this is from a NASA design, right? But they didn't think about all these things. There should be two ladders. There should be one ladder for going up and one ladder for going down. And again, the floor should be curved because that module has a wide radius base. You know, the floor is wide compared to the spin radius. And so the floor needs to be curved. Oops, sorry. I get my cursor. So we have a curved floor and we have two different ladders, one for going down, one for going up. And I'm also, this is sort of my hypothesis, that there should be visual cues in the architecture to help keep people oriented to their rotation. Because if you're just sitting in a chair, motionless in a room like this, even though it's rotating, you're not going to feel these Coriolis accelerations. Everything is sort of stable. You'll feel some gravity and everything's fine until you start to move. And as soon as you start to move, these Coriolis effects kick in and you try to move your hand like this, but it goes like this, or it goes like this, or it goes sideways. You try to stand up out of a chair and you're tipping one way or the other because of the Coriolis effects. And so my hypothesis is there should be visual cues in the environment to help keep people oriented, and that will help them to adapt. And what that looks like, I don't know. This is kind of hideous, but you know, you're all probably more brilliant designers than I am. So think, please think of something. Please think of how you would design this that people can look at that environment and keep track of which way they're rotating, because that will help them adapt. That's my theory, that's my hypothesis. And Coriolis is proportional to the relative velocity, as I mentioned before, and the velocity ratio is a metric of distortion. So here's this math again. And so there's an argument, well, if we have these huge colonies, they're very big and the velocity is, the rim speed is very fast, and so it won't matter anymore. But the bigger the habitat, the faster the inhabitants are going to want to move, right? If you've got something that's kilometers in circumference, I'm probably not walking around that thing anymore. I'm riding some kind of a tram or a scooter or something. And it all depends on the velocity ratio. The faster I move, the bigger this ratio, and the more the Coriolis kicks in. So here is a concept. This guy, Brian Versteeg, he does these absolutely immaculate, beautiful 3D renderings. He models this stuff in 3D and renders it with Unreal Engine or something, I don't know. But he does these spectacular concept models of huge space colonies. But how are people, you know, what are they going to do in here? Are they going to experience these Coriolis accelerations? You know, the artists like to depict like baseball diamonds or football pitches or something in these big colonies. I chose to look at golf, and I have this animation. Maybe I'll run this later, but this is something that runs on my desktop. I can demonstrate this later. In the bottom right corner is a control panel. I can set the radius, the rotation rate, and the gravity level with these sliders. And I can set the velocity of a particle, the initial height and the velocity of a particle. And this thing rotates and it animates what that particle is going to do. This view is my view out in inertial space. I watch this thing rotate and I watch what this particle does. And I can see that each particle is actually moving in a straight line, but each one's following a different straight line because they got launched at different times. And so it looks like there's an arc. So this is what somebody on that rotating space station would see relative to himself. And this is what his twin on Earth would see if he threw the particle the same way. So using the example of golf, I looked up an average drive for, you know, a good amateur or maybe a professional 200-yard drive, a little less than 183 meters. And the longest distance is going to be if you launch it at a, you know, an angle of 45 degrees. That's sort of the optimal angle for getting distance. And 42.35 meters per second is what it works out to be. So what happens if he tries to golf on that Kalpana station? If he drives to the east with the rotation, he's only getting about 77 meters on his drive. So it's somewhat less than what he got on Earth. On Earth, it would be 183 meters. Here it's only 77 because of upward curvature of the floor. And in a sense, the particle has more apparent gravity because it's adding to the rotation. And these are the parameters of the station, by the way. Radius of 250 meters. It's got a 1.89 rotations per minute, little under two, and the rim speed is 49.51 meters per second. Well, that's pretty close to the relative, right? The speed of that golf ball is 42 and the rim speed is only 49. So that's a pretty big ratio. So that already tells you something interesting is going to happen. If he drives the ball straight east, there's no Coriolis acceleration for motion. I'm sorry, straight south. He's driving the ball straight south. There's no Coriolis acceleration for motion parallel to the axis, but just the fact that it's going up and coming back down is causing it to deflect off to the east. So he tries to drive straight south. His distance south is 134 meters, but distance east is 51. So, you know, he's going to have to slice it more to the west to make it go south. And this is what happens if he actually tries to drive in the other direction. If he drives against the rotation, it does some pretty unexpected things. He's now getting 83 meters. So it actually isn't traveling much farther to the west than it does to the east in terms of the distance that he achieved, but it's taking a very different path. And if he angles it lower, if he can just about, again, because this velocity is almost equal to this one, if he drives at a very shallow angle, he's almost canceling the rotation of the station in a sense. So the ball is actually not moving. The ball is almost sitting motionless in inertial space, but he's rotating around and it's sort of coming up and hitting him in the butt kind of. So sort of an abrupt end, but that's it. Artificial gravity sort of question all assumptions. It's very different. It has its own rules and we have to reimagine everything. If anybody's interested, I can run that simulation or we can open it up for questions. I went longer than I intended by a lot, actually. Hopefully you're all still awake and not too bored listening to me. Yeah.
Thank you, Ted. Yes, please run the simulation. We have already.
Right. Okay, I can do that.
More. It is such a rich and comprehensive presentation. Thanks a lot. Very interesting to see this.
I didn't think I was going to talk that long.
Don't worry, it was super interesting. Actually, thank you for sharing your knowledge, which is still unique.
So, I wonder what is the function. So here's a guy. Oh, he's dropping a ball. He's not throwing it. Let's throw the ball a little bit. So if I throw, I hope you can see this. You see that particle in the top right corner? It's just moving in a straight line.
Okay, I think you have to share some other.
Oh, am I not sharing? Sorry. Maybe I'm sharing the wrong thing. I have to change my share. Here, right. Sorry. Okay, can you see that now? So the top right corner, you see the little man spinning around. And if he throws a particle, back here again. There we go. If he throws a particle, if you look in the top right corner, the particle's just moving in a straight line. If he throws a series of particles, you start to get this illusion that they're moving in a curve, but it's only because each particle is following a different straight line. And if you look in the top left corner, that's what he sees. It, to him, it looks like each individual particle is moving on some kind of a path. And so we know this isn't a comfortable environment. This is way outside the comfort conditions because it's almost 10 RPM. It is one gravity, but it's almost 10 RPM. If we were to reduce that to 3 RPM, for example. Sorry, that I did radius instead of RPM. Sorry about that. Three RPM. Now I got to make gravity big again. Sorry. It's back to one. There. Okay. So now at 3 RPM and one gravity, it's obviously a much, much bigger habitat. And things are not quite as weird as they were. And that gives you an idea why this would be a more comfortable environment. It's based on a bigger radius and a lower rotation rate. But if we play around, we can get it to do interesting things here. This was sort of the inspiration for that fountain, that my last slide, that picture of a fountain. We, you know, maybe we could achieve something like this, which I think would be pretty interesting if we had a big enough space station to do it in. But yeah, I can come down here and I can adjust the initial height and I can adjust the velocity. And so I use this to do all these experiments. I'm going to stop sharing again. Yeah, sorry I talked so long. I've talked about half an hour longer than I thought I would. I hope it wasn't too boring.
I don't think it was boring. It was very interesting. It showed a few things. But let's go to the questions, Nicolas. I think your question is the first one.
Yes, thank you very much for the interesting talk. I was wondering, at the beginning you showed different ideas for space stations, etc. And you said that tubes, of course, are very efficient because they are all in tension, basically. But I was wondering if in space it wouldn't make more sense to have like something like tensegrity structures from Buckminster Fuller to save even more material, for example, or to generate shapes that we are more familiar than around tube, basically. But I guess when we're talking about artificial gravity, then it makes sense, of course, to have a tube again, because we need the shape, basically, to be around and to need a hard surface on the outside. So I guess from that standpoint, it makes sense why you would want to use a tube, of course. But what do you think about tensegrity structures in space? Is it an option or is it something we're thinking should think about, or is it you completely useless?
Well, I think you have to be a little more specific about what kind of tensegrity structure, because some of them are just, you know, geodesic domes, I guess. It might make sense. It depends on the materials available to build it with, right? So tensegrity is usually there's some tension members and there's some compression members. And it might make a lot of sense because the lunar regolith, if we're going to build from that, it's probably better in compression than it is in tension. I don't have a picture of it in my presentation, but I've seen concepts for lunar structures where it was a tower shaped like this. And I thought, well, that's dumb. They don't know what they're doing. They don't understand the atmospheric pressure and tension. And then I read the justification for it, and I realized it's brilliant, actually, because if they curve the surface like this, then it's acting like an arch, right? That inward curvature is resisting the pressure in compression now instead of tension. And actually 3D printing is better suited for that, probably, if they're printing bricks, you know, or printing from regolith. It's probably going to be stronger in compression than it is in tension. And so something like this makes a lot of sense if you look at it that way. Still, you need tension, right? They're going to need some kind of a tension ring at the top, or this thing is still just going to split apart. But it might be a small amount of material compared to, you know, the bulk of the material is a compression material that's inward curved. And then you import some titanium cable or whatever it takes around the top for that compression ring at the top and the bottom. So, yeah, I think there's lots of possibilities that haven't been fully explored yet. You got to look at the forces. It's all about, you know, you have to remember that atmospheric pressure is, in American terms, we'd say a ton per square foot. I mean, it's a lot of pressure pushing out on this thing. And that is the first thing you have to resist. You have to somehow contain that pressure.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Nicolas. Also, Elisa?
It was just a very small question out of curiosity. I don't know if you've seen the movie Interstellar with Matthew McConaughey. Yeah. They also use their like a fast spin on their space station to obtain gravity. It is like the same theory as the centripetal acceleration, as you explained here.
Yeah, any sort of rotating structure that you see in space, that's what they're basing it on. They might call it centrifugal, but it's centripetal, actually. The fact that when you're inside of some rotating thing, you've got the floors pushing you in toward the center all the time. And that's what's creating a sense of gravity. I like to sort of scrutinize some of these movies sometimes. I forget if it was Interstellar or The Martian. It was one or the other. And they showed somebody in like the neutral axis of this thing in the weightless area. And he's sort of going along the axis until he gets to a spoke going, you know, into the rotating section. And as soon as he lines up with that, it's like there's some magical force that pulls him down that tube. And that's not going to happen. That's based, whoever designed that was based on the idea, oh, there's some centrifugal force that's going to pull him down. No, there isn't. He's going to float right past that spoke. He's going to have to somehow pull himself down into that spoke to get started. And then, you know, once he starts moving down that thing, he'll move down. But there's nothing that's going to sort of suck him down that spoke just because he lined up with it. That's tangential to your question, but yeah. Any of these rotating structures that you see in sci-fi movies, yeah, they're all based on the same thing, whether they know it or not.
Thank you. Eva?
Hello. So I am very interested in what do you think if people or like if people will be open to live on the moon or on Mars, or you also showed maybe in the orbit. And with that question, I ask myself if it would have to be the decision against living on the Earth, or would you look at the habitable space in the orbit more as an opportunity to travel between Earth and orbit?
That's a very individual question, but there are a lot of people that are very excited about the idea of space habitats. And their reasons for that are, you know, many for adventure, because they don't like the political climate on Earth. I mean, there's just lots of people that there are as many reasons as there are people, probably. But I mean, you can look at human history and ask, why did humans ever move from where they were, you know, to some other place? You know, why did the first humans cross that land bridge from Siberia to Alaska? And why were they just following the herds of mastodons and suddenly found themselves on a new continent? Or there's also some theory that Polynesian people may have done island hopping to get all the way across the Pacific. You know, why did they do that? Why did they get in a canoe? How did they get to Hawaii and why did they go there? You know, that was a long canoe trip. Why did they do that? Who knows, but people have their reasons. A lot of people, not everybody, like the idea of exploration and going to new places. And it's, you know, it's very exciting for them. And other people are just trying to escape from something they don't like where they are. It could be as simple as job opportunities, if that's an economy that opens up. And there's some space colony and they say, yeah, we need engineers, we need barbers, we need chefs. We have a resort, right? We need housekeepers on our resort. People will follow adventure, they'll follow opportunities, and it won't be everybody. Nobody's saying everybody has to go, but the argument is that if enough people go, it's going to become its own population, and it's just going to become a new branch of humanity almost.
Mm-hmm. So you think of it more as an extension of opportunities and less as a decision against something?
I would say it's up to the individual. For some people, it will be a decision against. For some people, it will be, I hate this place. I don't like the politics. I don't like the, you know, whatever. I'm going to get with people who think like me, and we're just going to go start over, right? I'm going to get a few thousand of my closest, you know, people I sympathize with, or people that, you know, think the way I do, and we're going to go start a new society. You know, some of the pilgrims that European pilgrims who came to North America early in the colonization period, that, you know, they were looking for religious liberty or whatever. You know, they didn't want to follow the rules of Europe. They wanted to make their own rules. And they ended up coming to America, and in their own way, they were as oppressive as the thing they left sometimes. But, you know, people have their reasons. And some people, for some, it's just get rich quick, right? Some people came to America just to make a buck on ranching and, or, you know, prospecting for gold. And for other people, it was for religious freedom. And for other people, it was, you know, maybe they were runaways from, you know, draft dodgers or something, who knows? Everybody's going to have their own reason. There's no simple answer to that question.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks a lot. That was a beautiful answer. So it's up to you. And I think what you meant is an extension. We will not have made the decision of staying or leaving by a few people.
Yeah, it's not some dictator who's going to say, okay, everybody off the earth, right? That's not going to happen.
Because you are building the future. Was this okay, Eva? What was your thought? No, I'm interested. What do you think?
Yes, no, I was just wondering because it was also explained that it might not be so easy, or at least it has to be figured out, because living in space does change the human body. So it has to be figured out how it wouldn't affect the body so much that maybe it isn't possible anymore to come back to the earth. And just
question. That is one of the main rationales for artificial gravity, is that we can preserve health. Mm. If we go to Mars, there might not be any coming back to Earth unless you really vigorously, you know, have a very, you know, strong regime of exercise and training to get back to Earth, almost like an Olympic athlete, just to be able to come back to Earth, and more so for the moon. But if we build these big rotating colonies, the idea is they will have Earth gravity, and you'll be able to, you know, if you can book a seat, if you can book a ticket, health will not be the issue going back and forth.
Okay. Yeah. No, I think it's just the human nature, maybe, that we are also always like scared of new things. But I don't think that it was ever a barrier we didn't take. So thank you again.
You're welcome.
Thanks a lot, Eva. Heidi?
Yes. Thank you for your informative lecture. My question is more about a smaller detail, but maybe it's still important, because I noticed on the one rendering you showed of the rotating colony that there was a lot of vegetation, many trees, and I was wondering if trees could actually grow normally with artificial gravity, or would they grow differently than we know it from Earth? And do plants actually need gravity to grow? Do you know that?
There's a lot of experimentation being done in microgravity on the International Space Station. They're really looking for, they would like to grow their own food. They know that to go to Mars, they're going to have to find plants that, you know, they have to bring stuff, or they have to grow stuff. They would like to be able to bring seeds or seedlings to Mars and grow their own food, because you can't pack enough food, basically. So there's a lot of experiments. There are some plants that do okay in microgravity. Anything that will grow in if it evolved in gravity on Earth, it will probably be fine in microgravity, unless it's a very, very short radius. The main thing has to do with, like, you know, water transport, how the roots take up water and how water transpires from the leaves and things like that. You know, if you put a seed in the ground, how does it know which way to grow, which way is up, this sort of thing. But artificial gravity will provide those cues, and the plant is not going to get dizzy. The plant's probably not going to care, you know, as long as there's a gravity vector that tells the roots which way to go and the water which way to go, they'll probably do fine.
And they would still grow completely straight.
Yeah, because the rate of growth is so slow, there isn't going to be any significant Coriolis acceleration. It would have to grow pretty fast for that to have any effect. And plants don't grow straight on Earth. The wind and everything shapes all the plants here. There are lots of things in nature that I've never seen a straight tree. I mean, maybe spruce trees, you know, or something, but most trees are pretty crooked. So, and they did some studies when they were doing those colony studies in the 1970s. They did some research on how much agricultural area do we need, you know, and they were pulling up things like, you know, they pulled up some architectural standards and some, you know, different sorts of urban planning standards for how much agricultural area do you need per person, you know, and if we have this urban population, and if we do very efficient farming, how much green space do we need? But in the grander scale things, they know that people like green areas. They just like parks. You know, it's not all farm fields. So they're intentionally drawing those big open green areas because they're trying to make it look attractive, right? They know that makes it look attractive. And so that's what they're aiming for.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks a lot. Interesting question. Maybe I can add something because there was recently some research on that light is also a very important trigger. And yes. That it has been proven that plants grow towards light.
Yes.
And the proper lighting it's not the topic of this talk, but very important for architects, you know, daylighting and artificial lighting, the colors, the intensity, the cycle. So there are a lot of characteristics that you as an architect can provide in order for people and in order for plants to grow. Thanks a lot. Julian.
So when you showed the YouTube videos of the spinning wheel from NASA, I remembered a concept for a Mars habitat, which I saw a while ago, where they used like a donut shape and slopes which spun to achieve like 1G of gravity. And when you explained us all the effects of Coriolis, I don't know how to pronounce it, but which it already have been like this simple spinning wheel in microgravity. Do you think it's feasible to do that on Mars or Moon, or is it completely, or would it completely mess up the human body?
It might be confusing. It's hard to answer. It's one of those things where, you know, they'll have to test it eventually. I've seen similar concepts of building something on the surface of the moon, like in a crater, building some sort of road. I've seen concepts that build like a train, basically, that runs around on a track, and the people are living on a train that just is continually driving around this track. If you do the math to get one gravity on the moon and even on Mars, you know, do the sort of, you know, you've got the planetary gravity this way and you've got the centripetal gravity this way. This turns out to be a much bigger component than this. And so even on Mars, to get one gravity, it's surprisingly close to horizontal. It's very, very, you know, very, very sort of shallow angle for that vertical. My biggest question is, how do you power that thing? How do you build a structure that big and keep it rotating that fast? You know, what do you do about friction, right? Did they build some sort of frictionless maglev? You know, I've seen concepts that they try to take magnetic levitation as used in some high-speed trains on Earth and use that to sort of levitate this rotating thing to keep it, you know, frictionless, but then where is all the energy coming from for those magnets? I mean, it's a huge energy problem. If they can build it, it'll be bizarre because the gravity is going to be very skewed, right? Because there's always going to be some planetary gravity this way, and then you've got the centripetal component this way. And so if you think about your body axis, it's not aligned with the gravity axis isn't aligned with any of your principal axes, right? It's not aligned this way. It's not aligned this way. It's all kind of twisted sort of. People are remarkably adaptable. People can adapt to lots of things, but I do believe that's going to take some adaptation if they can build it and power it. I think it might be a moot question because I'm not sure. I'm not sure you could power such a thing. But it's been discussed, especially on the moon. You know, they talk about colonizing the moon, but 1/6 gravity, you know, it's highly questionable whether you could raise children normally in such a low gravity. Even on Mars, 0.38 G is questionable.
Okay, thank you.
Good.
Thank you very much, Ted. Also, Julian, for the question. Sarah.
Thank you very much for your lecture. I was just wondering, since you mentioned how space colonies in the future could also be provider of working places and similar. So my question is, what is your estimation or your opinion, when could space colonies become our reality? So something more, let's say, normal and approachable to regular people, not only to scientists and astronauts. Thank you.
Smarter people than me have studied this question, you know, and they've done lots of economic studies and resource studies. I never say never, I guess, is my attitude. I think it could happen. I'm not going to predict when, but if somebody tells me, oh, it can never happen in the whole, when I look at how much things have changed just in my lifetime, in my 65 years of life, let alone the past 200 years, right? If you look at just what has happened in the past 200 or 300 years of human industrial development, if somebody tells me something is never going to happen, I don't believe you. Life 100 years from now is going to be unimaginably different than it is now, because the progress of change is sort of exponential. And I would be amazed to see what life is going to be like just 100 years from now, whether it's going to be Star Trek. And, you know, I think interstellar travel is a long way off, because there are some fundamental physical barriers with getting to even the nearest star. So the resources we have, I think, are going to be the resources of this solar system for a long time. So I listed those planets, right? I think those are the planets we're stuck with, if you want to put it that way, for a long time. I think it's going to be hundreds of years at least before humans get out of this star system. But there's a lot of resources in this star system, and you know, the cost of putting a satellite in orbit has dropped by an order of magnitude just in the past few years with reusable rockets. And there's, you know, in 1957, the Soviet Union put up the first satellite, one little beach ball that went beep, beep, beep. And now there are tens of thousands of satellites orbiting the Earth. I mean, every day Elon Musk is launching another, you know, 50 satellites, it seems like. There is so much, it's so common now all of a sudden to be throwing satellites into orbit and putting people in orbit. You know, China has its own space station now. They had 6 astronauts in orbit just a few days ago. Now they're back down to 3, because 3 were up there for 6 months and 3 came back. And those 3 new ones up there. You know, when I was growing up, China was seen as this backward, you know, unindustrial country. And India also, China and India were like, you know, poster children for sort of backward, undeveloped countries. And now both of those countries have vibrant space programs. India sends, you know, satellites into orbit. China sends satellites into orbit. It's changing very quickly. The whole space industry is changing very, very quickly. So I will never say it's never going to happen.
Probably it will happen, but we don't know when.
We don't know when, yeah.
May not be in our times. May not
be. I don't expect to see it in my lifetime, but I believe it will happen. There are enough people with enough interest that I believe it will. A very serious effort will be made, let's put it that way. And unless some fundamental barrier comes up, they're going to keep trying and trying and trying until they do it. That's my prediction. It may not be as fast as they would like, but I believe it will happen. There are a couple of billionaires on this planet who are very interested. Jeff Bezos, Elon Musk makes a big deal about colonizing Mars. My understanding is that Jeff Bezos is much more interested in this rotating space colony concept. That's his focus more. He doesn't talk as much as Musk does. He's very quiet about stuff, but I've heard he's more interested in the free orbiting artificial gravity habitats. And when you've got $200 billion to play with, you can do a lot of stuff.
Yeah, true. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sarah. Do we have one more question? What I've seen today, and what I did not expect it, that I invited Ted Hall because he is really one of, or the expert in gravity, artificial gravity. But now when listening to him and your questions, I think in addition to explaining the concept of gravity and its relation to space architecture and to the human being, he has shown how important architecture is and the role of the architect. You know, he has really shown that architecture can make your life easy or difficult. And he has also shown or exemplified with his examples that how important it is for the architect, the engineer, the designer, the planner, to take the environment and the human into consideration. This is a very important message, and probably no matter where we are on Earth or in space or what the future is, it is relevant to know for which environment you're planning and looking at the humans, what they're doing. And thank you, Ted. You showed some super examples where it's just not enough to produce images or to make a nice design.
Well, thanks for the invitation. And I apologize again for talking so long. I get started and I can't stop. I hope it was reasonably interesting.
I thank you so much for taking the time and sharing your knowledge with us and answering the questions. Thank you all. Have a good day, Ted.
Thank you.
And we have a good evening.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you for tuning in.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Bye.
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 Thank you, bye.